Most medical research has been conducted in a fair and reasonable fashion, but there have been a small number of regrettable incidences in which the subjects of medical research were not treated fairly. They may have been given no option but to participate, as has happened to some prison inmates and military personnel. In some cases, research subjects were not told that they were participating in research, or were not told about known risks of what was involved. In one study in which the effects of syphilis were being observed, penicillin was withheld from patients for more than 20 years after it was known to be effective. This was because the researchers in the Tuskegee syphilis study wished to observe the behaviour of the untreated condition. Episodes like this, in which research subjects were not treated in a way we would expect to be treated ourselves, led to regulation of medical research with the aim of preventing recurrences. Over several decades, the current system of ethical committee approval was developed. When considering randomised trials, ethical committees have to decide whether it is reasonable to choose at random between two different treatments. If current evidence suggests clearly in the minds of the medical profession that a particular treatment is the best one, then it would be unfair to withhold that treatment from people suffering from the disease, which means it would be unfair to randomise between the two treatments. Medicine has borrowed the term equipoise from law to describe the necessary condition for ethical randomisation. In legal terms, it relates to a situation in which the weight of evidence in favour of one side of an issue is equal to the weight of evidence in favour of the other. Friedman introduced the term to medicine in 1987 and took it to mean a situation where each of two competing treatments has a reasonable body of professional opinion to support it. If this condition exists, then ethical committees can approve a trial. Equipoise, defined in this way, is a good enough condition for a trial to begin ethically, but not to bring it to a successful conclusion in many fields. In drug trials, if there are reasonable bodies of professional opinion for and against the use of the drug, it means that professionals on either side of the issue will probably be able to agree that they cannot be confident in their opinion. The evidence available to them on the behaviour of drugs, particularly newly introduced drugs, is virtually all from published research, which is accessible to everyone. Furthermore, there is no difference between the drug administered by one person and by another, so there is no problem in accepting that the conclusions of one professional's published results are applicable to another's practice. As you might expect, however, things are not always so simple. One field in which equipoise, as applied by ethical committees, is not enough to bring a randomised trial to a successful conclusion is surgery. A surgical operation is a dramatic life event for a patient. It carries risks of death or permanent disability, as well as the potential for immediate and lasting relief of symptoms or prolongation of life. The patient often has no option but to place faith in the skill and judgment of the surgeon. The surgeon takes seriously the formation of their recommendations and judgments and gives the patient relevant information. In addition, surgical operations are difficult to do, and outcomes depend on how well they are performed, and surgeons do the operations themselves. In general, to be competent at an operation, surgeons have to have done it many times, and they cannot help but gain experience in how their patients do after the operation as they personally perform it. Much of the existing evidence used by surgeons comes from their own personal experience and that of their teachers and mentors, rather than in published form, and equipoise varies between surgeons with differences in opinion and different skills. This gives them a body of information about how to counsel patients that is gained from direct personal experience. This is a very different situation from advising a patient whether or not to take a drug. Patients deciding whether or not to have an operation are counseled by individual surgeons. When they come to their decision, one factor that usually carries little weight is what other surgeons would or would not recommend. Patients are interested primarily in what their surgeon recommends and the reasons for it. That being so, if a patient and surgeon are considering randomisation, then the ethical committee principle of equipoise has little relevance because it does not refer to the individual surgeon's opinion, but simply to there being a substantial and competent body of surgeons who recommend each option. The condition under which patients are happy to be randomised is when they and their own surgeon discuss all the issues and available information and still cannot decide which treatment is best. This is the meaning of equipoise that I will adopt. There are two reasons for using the same term, despite the possible confusion with the way it is used by ethical committees. Firstly, it is the same as the original legal meaning, where the evidence does not lead those involved in a specific case one way or the other. Secondly, it is what most surgeons mean by the term. The difference between equipoise in medicine and surgery makes surgical equipoise specific to surgeon-patient combinations. Although there may be a lack of randomised trial data for a particular procedure, that will not leave surgeons with no opinion about its value, so it is difficult for equipoise to be defined by one surgeon for another, or by trial organisers for investigating surgeons. This means that it is difficult to get agreement between surgeons on what trials should be done and what the inclusion criteria should be. The large scale of trials necessarily means that they have to be done by many clinicians in collaboration, and a lack of common equipoise makes it difficult to design them. Furthermore, trials have to be funded, and that funding is decided on by research committees. The same lack of common equipoise makes it difficult to design trials in the first place, and also makes it difficult to achieve agreement on committees as to what should be investigated, making it difficult to fund surgical trials. Another consequence of equipoise adds to the lack of support that surgical trials receive. Surgeons have equipoise and are prepared to randomise patients only when they feel the potential benefits of surgery are closely matched by the potential risks. They generally have extensive experience of the results of the operations that they do, so they are likely to be quite accurate in this assessment. If so, the trial will be neutral or will show little effect, as is often seen in trials of surgical procedures. As a consequence, surgeons tend not to be motivated to join proposed trials because they think, often correctly, that the result will not change practice. The null-seeking trial was designed to address problems relating to consensus, support for trials and recruitments in the field of surgery, but the principles are general and can be applied to any alternative treatments.